This week on the Internet Cafe, online gaming. This is Acrophobia, one of the hottest new games on the web where you can win prizes. Meet the game wizard known as Thresh. He's earned $100,000 and a Ferrari playing computer games. If you're into strategy fantasy games, check out NetStorm, the first game of its type designed especially for multiplayer action. And this is Rebecca Anderson. You've seen her picture on Ping, the online gaming section at a website called GameSpot. And if you're into online gambling at places like Virtual Vegas, stay tuned for some good advice. Online gaming, this week at the Internet Cafe. NetCafe is made possible by RonDiamond.com, the oldies site on the Internet. Music and memories from the 50s, 60s, and 70s, not just another jukebox. Additional support comes from the law offices of Ivan Hoffman, lawyering with integrity for Internet law, copyright, trademark, and other intellectual property law. And by TechWeb for up-to-the-minute technology news.
All right, so we're talking about online gaming, and the issue here, it seems to me, people say online gaming is better than, you know, the CD-ROM type stuff because it's not you and the computer, it's the kid against another kid somewhere else around the world. Do you think it's still a healthy form of social interaction? It's still a kid in a machine, isn't it?
Well, I think it's the only place that really kind of lives up to this promise of, you know, building a community on the web. I mean, I've seen clans and guilds and things where people get together. But I still think they're basically playing against each other, not really a good, you know, discourse going on, just kind of shoot them up, you know.
So trying to kill each other.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, that's
right.
What do you think, Mom? Suppose your kid were there. Well, if you were a mom, I know you're not a mom. But I mean, if you had a kid, like we're talking about it from a kid's perspective.
Yeah.
There's a lot of, you know, young boys are doing this kind of thing.
Well, I don't know. I guess I don't like to shoot them up, kill them, and, you know, stab stuff. But I don't know. I think I'd much rather them be doing that than hanging out at the mall getting into drugs or something like that. So, I mean, if they're
well, that's
playing
easy.
Games and stuff like that. Or
but
watching
how about compared
TV?
To going outside and playing with real kids,
oh,
you know?
But I don't think that, you know, online gaming is I shouldn't say it's sweeping, but I don't think for the most part it's a replacement for playing with kids. I just think that it's a replacement for TV, for example.
I don't think it's much better than TV. I mean, most of the games.
I don't know.
I mean, there are some good games
some
out there,
good.
And some are fun. But I see a lot of these shoot 'em up games, and those are the games that kids want. And the more
yeah.
extreme,
but the kids are playing with guns outside
but the
too.
More extreme, right? Exactly.
It depends on what skills you want your kids to
that's
learn.
Right, that's right. So, Rebecca, you're the editor for GameSpot Ping website. Now, tell me, first of all, what's GameSpot all about?
GameSpot is an online gaming magazine that covers PC gaming. So, if you're looking for a review of a PC game or a demo for a game or a patch for a game, you can find that on GameSpot.
Now, what's Ping?
Ping is a subsection of GameSpot. It's the online gaming section. So, that's where you can find information about online gaming services and games you can play online.
So, now, what kind of games can I play online? What are my choices?
Oh, man. I keep saying the world is getting better and better for online gamers because there's pretty much nothing you can't play online. I mean, it's
there's
all there.
There's no limit?
Not yet.
Now, help me understand. Now, I understand CD-ROM-based games. You load them, you play them. Now, what is an online game? Is it basically a CD-ROM-based game where you log into a server and you start playing, or is there something different that goes on in the online gaming world? Is there something unique that you can do there that you couldn't do?
Well, you can play a CD-ROM game online. In fact, a lot of services require that you have a copy of
right.
the game to play online. Then there are some games that are built for the Internet, and so you can only play them online. They were developed for that reason.
So now what's the benefit of using an online-only game? What's so cool about those?
Well, you get to play with other people, which I think is really cool, because once you've mastered, you know, the artificial intelligence of a game,
right.
you know, you already kind of know what the game's going to do when you move around, but to take it to another level is really cool, and you can do that with people.
So now when I think about gaming, and I think about Quake, and I think about Doom, and I think about folks that spend, you know, hours and hours playing these games, I mean, they're totally involved in this. Now, for me personally, I'm probably not going to have a lot of time to spend hours and hours to learn how to play a game, and plus, I kind of just want a quick fix. Are there any games that I can play that solve my needs?
Oh, yeah. In fact, there's several online-only games that are quick fixes. There's one called War Sport where you can just get in and get out in about 30 minutes. It's sort of played like a sport, so there's two 10-minute quarters and a half.
Right.
And, you know, just get in and get out. There's some really great places where you can play games, you know, 5 minutes or less, things like that.
So what do you think the future holds for online gaming?
I still think it's trying to figure itself out.
Yeah.
There's still a lot of people in the market that are providing games for people online, but there don't seem to be the number of bodies out there that, you know...
That want to play?
That want to play, or that they've really attracted to the services yet.
Is it expensive? I mean, how much is it going to cost me to go online and play a game? Is it free?
For some places, it's free. It can go anywhere from free all the way up to an hourly rate. It just depends on the service that you pick and the games that you want to play.
So it's a pretty broad range.
Yeah.
So what else? What else would I find at Ping? I mean, if I wanted to get a little bit more information about some of the hottest things, what are some of the things that you have at Ping that I would like?
Well, first, I have a weekly column where I sort of do a roundup of the hot things that are going on online. And then from that homepage, there's also my favorite is the Take 5, which I find a place where you can play a game and be up and running in less than 5 minutes. Because the big thing...
Oh, now I like the sound of that.
Yeah, because the big thing with playing games online sometimes, it takes you an hour to download it.
Exactly.
You know, and this is like, I promise it won't take any more than 5 minutes for you to be up and running and playing a game. It may be a silly little game.
Like
but,
what?
Oh, like I have Headball, which you like, it's like Pong with this little head in the
okay.
middle. And you can customize it, too.
So I can put any head I want?
You have to pay them. You have to pay the company for it. But yeah, you can. And you watch the little head go back and forth, you know. There's one, too, that someone has taken the refrigerator magnet,
uh-huh.
and they put it into a Java applet, and you can create sentences.
Oh, so I can make poetry on my
oh,
fridge?
Yeah, it's called poetry. Yeah, that's it. It's called poetry.
Excellent. That sounds really cool. Thanks a lot, Rebecca.
Thanks.
All right, Anthony, you've created this new game on the web called Acrophobia, and what's the game about?
Acrophobia is a word game on the internet. 14 people in a chat room see a randomly generated acronym of 3 to 7 letters with a category attached, and the object is to create what you think a funny or witty acronym would be that worked with those letters in the category. People vote on the ones they like, and you get more votes. You do well.
Okay. Now, you created this game when you were a college student and you were bored or something. Tell us how it all started.
Well, back when I was in school, I used acronyms to remember facts and things like that. Like, you know,
little mnemonics for remembering stuff you got to memorize
right,
for school.
Like for the Great Lakes, you'd put homes, you know, Huron, Ontario, etc.
Right.
So I would use that to remember certain facts, and I'd create funny ones to go along with that. And that became a running joke, and eventually I made a game about it.
Uh-huh.
I put the game together on an internet chat room. I had a friend of mine program it with
uh-huh.
my rules, and it took off pretty well. I brought it to Berkeley Systems in the summer of 96, and it's launched now.
All right, Berkeley Systems, they're the guys who did You Don't Know Jack, which is one of the most successful games both in software and on the web also.
Yeah.
Now, what's the relationship there? Is this in the same place as You Don't Know Jack?
Yeah, both the games are on our free online network called Berserk. We've got three games. We've got You Don't Know Jack, the Net Show.
Right.
We've got a sports version called Jack Sports, the Net Show. We've got Acrophobia. We've got some 25,000 people that come
wow.
every night and play the game, and you know they stay for like 30 or 40 minutes and they play it.
Now, it's cool. Acrophobia, you say, have kind of started in a chat room. This is really a social kind of game, right? It's
yeah.
like kibitzing at the table while you're playing the game.
Yeah, it's great. It's great because Acrophobia is kind of like a built-in icebreaker to meet new people.
Uh-huh.
The game takes place at the top of the screen, the chat box mm-hmm. at the bottom, and people can talk with each other. They can talk about the acronyms that just appeared,
right.
and it sparks conversation, and they can meet new people on the net and not play with total strangers.
So you play the game. First of all, when you play the game, you can actually win prizes and stuff?
Yeah, we give away prizes. We also give away cash. If you're in a chat room just randomly, we might happen to give you some cash.
Uh-huh.
The person that wins the most amount of games throughout the entire month gets $1,000 for now. And, you know, I mean, we've given away, on Berserk, we've given away trips to the Bahamas and
uh-huh.
flights and cruises. So, I mean, it's a pretty big deal.
All right, now you've got an adult section and a clean section. What was the idea behind that?
Well, there are some people on the internet that are a little less social, but they still want to play games.
Right.
And or they may not be less social, but they may want to deal with more, you know, kind of like a more mature
yeah,
themes.
Yeah.
And you know, we don't want to say no. We don't want you here.
So here's
we
your
put
place.
Them in a section.
And here's your place.
Right. So we've got like 25 game rooms where the people can go there and talk about these sorts of things. We've got some 70 game. We've got 70 other game rooms where the clean, more pure
right.
experience can take place. But I mean, they all play, and it's yeah. it's a thing.
What's really interesting is the way you're handling the ads or the commercials, because it's really more like TV than banner ads on a typical website.
Yeah, banner ads on a website, they just happen to be there, and you're not really looking for that. Like if you go to a search site,
right.
you're looking for what you searched for. Our interstitials take place every 3 rounds. That's about every 6 minutes or
yeah.
so. So it's like a TV show. It takes over your screen. For about 10 seconds each, we run 2 at a time. And it's got movement, it's got sound. We've got advertisers like TBS,
mm-hmm.
Amstel, we've got mm-hmm. US Robotics. And these ads, you know, they really make an impression, and they keep the game free. Like we said, I mean, the game is free to download, it's free to play,
yeah.
and people really like enjoy the ads and, you know, can more than put up with it because it's paying for their experience.
Yeah, and you've really got this right combination going there, the social experience. Yeah. You get to meet people and you play the game at the same time. It's not you and the computer.
Right, yeah. It's a, and the great thing is, I mean, the average game goes about 15 minutes.
Uh-huh.
So it's not like a persistent world-type game where you
have to spend hours.
I mean, you can, at lunch, you can log in with a couple of your friends from work. When you go home after dinner, you can play with your, you know, your wife or your mom or,
okay,
you know.
Acrophobia at berserk.com.
www.berserk.com.
Thanks, Anthony.
Thanks. So who better to introduce a fantasy game called NetStorm than Jonathan Knight, K-N-I-G-H-T. That sounds like you are maybe one of the characters in there. Now,
right.
I've heard some crazy things about NetStorm, that it's a kind of a far-out premise. Can you kind of enlighten me on what the game is really all about?
Sure. NetStorm is a real-time strategy game. It's a very exciting game. It takes place in a world called Nimbus.
Okay, so when you say strategy, you're meaning it's not just like your kill-em-all kind of a Quake or Doom.
Exactly. You take control of a floating island, and it's a strategy game in the sense that there's a lot of action, but you really got to figure out what you're doing. You have a lot of pieces at your disposal, and you're placing them down, and you're moving, and you're building bridges, and you're trying to attack the other guy, but you've got
to
think about what you're doing.
The object is you're
now, the object of the game is you have a high priest, and everybody else in the game.
As we all do, and should, yes.
Of course.
Okay.
if you're playing the computer or against other people on the internet, they also have a high priest. And your objective is actually capture their high priest and bring him back to your island, and you have an altar where you sacrifice him to the furies of Nimbus.
You sacrifice the high priest.
That's right.
So this is a game that's really popular among certain religious groups in this country, I'm sure.
Right.
Has there been a controversy about, you know, this kind of stuff?
Well, not really. Again, it takes place in a fantasy world that's completely made up. It's a really whimsical, you know, wonderful place.
Right.
And it's a high priest, and it's not exactly denominational.
Okay.
I mean, you sort of use your imagination.
So you think you're probably not offending any groups with that.
I hope not.
Or gamers are just way out there and they don't care. Is that probably what it's...
I think the gamers like it a lot.
Okay.
And it's a very competitive game in the sense that you really just want to, like, go for that one more priest. Because the thing about the game is the more priests you sacrifice, the stronger you're going to be the next time you go into battle. So it's a real sort of pecking order ranking system. You know, the guy that sacrificed 135 priests is going to be more powerful
say that this sort of controversial hook is what sort of keeps people coming back to these games? I mean, these are sort of, that's the enticement, really.
I think so. In some cases, I like to think NetStorm is just a really good, fun game, but part of the really fun part of it is sacrificing that priest, definitely.
Okay. Now, there's a strange psychology here, but we won't go into that.
Okay.
Now, you told me this is a game that is designed specifically for the net. And,
that's right.
You know, I'm wondering, is, you know, there's been a lot of just regular PC-based games, and this one is more internet-related. What are some of the areas that you have to, you know, change or add or develop to make it a net-based game?
Right, yeah. NetStorm is definitely one of the most sort of forward-thinking net games out there because, unlike, there's a lot of games where they sort of tack on the internet, you know,
after,
at the end.
Right,
it's sort of an afterthought.
Sure.
And you got a lot of latency, and it's just not designed well.
Okay.
And
latency, what do you...
Latency, right, which is, you know, it's lag, you're playing, you know, it's a wide network, it takes time for information to get across the country. And
so if I'm sitting in my house, basically, I could shoot and someone may not see it for a few seconds because there's a lag in
that's
the,
exactly
in the phone
right, and when someone's castle gets blown up or whatever, you really want it to happen at the same time on everyone's machine or people get annoyed.
Right.
So with NetStorm, Titanic Entertainment, who created the game, decided they were going to solve that problem, and also some other things like... connectivity, internet connections are often going down.
Right.
NetStorm allows you to
get
right back in when that happens
and
pick up where you left off.
So if you lose your connection, if your grandma picks up the phone or something that, and you have to get back on, it...
you go right back in, and actually your island will still be there and your pieces will still be fighting for you. So that's exciting.
That's a good feature. Now, what about people wanting to find each other? That seems to be the most common problem.
It's a very common problem, and for us it was kind of the most important feature of the game, and it's called the Challenge Arena, and that's where you go to find people. And what we've done is we've created a completely sort of elegant graphical interface to the player matching, which sounds like it would be a simple, easy sort of thing to do, but no one's really doing that. And what that means is that you can just look at the screen and see the other people out there in a graphical world that fits with the fiction of the game, And you'll see their names and what level they are and if they're strong or weak. Because that's the problem is that a lot of people are what we call newbies, and they just want to learn and they're just getting going, but they get crushed by the people that have been playing for 6 months nonstop.
So you can go and click on these things and find them.
Yeah, and you can see people.
I think you may have convinced me to go try to sacrifice a few priests.
Check it out.
Okay.
Well, here at CyberSmith tonight is Larry Magid, syndicated columnist for the LA Times and contributing editor for Home PC Magazine. We're going to pick your brain a bit, Larry. Sure. We're talking about gaming tonight. A lot of people go online, want to play a game or do other things, and it says, whoop, you need this plug-in to do the audio, to do the video, to do the multimedia. And 90% of the people say, quit, too complicated, I'm not going to do it. Is there a simple way to handle this problem of plugins?
Well, I don't know of a simple way, but there are some things that you should watch for. First of all, you want to make sure you can find it once you download it. So create a directory on your disk, like download, and make sure you always download them
so
to the same directory.
So there's a specific place where these things
Absolutely.
Are.
Second of all, once you do download it, you have to run it. Now, before you download it, by the way, be aware of the fact that there are viruses on some sites, so make sure you trust the site.
How do you know what you trust?
If it's a site you've heard of, if you have
big
friends...
Big company, well-known name.
You have friends that play the game, word of mouth.
Not Joe Blow's homepage.
No, I'd be careful downloading something there. So you run the program off of your download directory, and it's a regular Windows 95 or Macintosh install. And then, if all goes well,
cross your fingers.
You just run it, and you go back to the site, and it should work. Now, if it doesn't work, unfortunately, then you need to look at the documentation, which is usually right there on the website, and hopefully they'll have some trial and error.
But theoretically, the next time you go to that website and want to do the same thing, it will automatically find the plugin on your hard drive?
That website, exactly.
That website.
Yes.
But another website may be wanting another plugin.
Exactly. So it's very specific. It's per website. And some of these will work with several websites, some are just one website.
We just want to get to the point where plugins are automatic, huh?
Not that easy. Not
Thanks,
yet.
Larry.
So, Dennis, you are a gamer extreme. Like, you're sort of like this god in the online gamer community. Now, tell me, how did you get into this?
My two brothers are really into computers. And back then, when I was, 15, 16, I wasn't really into computers. I was more into sports and stuff. And, one day I just walked by my little brother's room and I heard all these sounds, and I was like, what's that? And from there, basically...
So what was it? What was the game?
It was Doom.
Okay, so that was the hook that got you in.
Yeah, it looked awesome. The sounds are great. All this killing and, shooting and stuff,
Yeah, I'm really into that.
but what 15-year-old wouldn't, go, what's that?
So now, let me kind of set the stage here. You're 20 years old right now. And you've been a professional gamer, what I'd like to call a cyber athlete, for a while now. Mm-hmm. And the games that you play are which ones? So you've got Doom, and what else do you play?
I play Doom, Doom 2, Quake 2, Warcraft 2.
So is it mostly shoot 'em up kind of games?
I guess my specialty would be shoot 'em up games, but I have played, Warcraft 2 is more of a strategy, real-time strategy game, and I really like that.
So now what's cool, you've won quite a lot of money. This is a serious professional sport. How much money have you won?
I wouldn't say money, I would more, it's like prizes.
Equal
and obviously, close to about 100,000,
right.
give
and
or take.
I think you drive a fairly nice car these days.
Yeah, the Ferrari was a prize for a tournament.
So this is pretty serious stuff for a 20-year-old, right?
Well, yeah, certainly a Ferrari is pretty.
So now, what's the trick? What makes a really good gamer? What's the trick?
I don't think there's really a trick. I would just say practice. Practice definitely is the key.
So how many hours do you think you played a day, for example, to get to where you're
nowadays?
At? No, then to get to where you are now.
I played about 2 hours. Sometimes three.
Okay.
It really depends. Or depended on. What was coming up. If it was a big tournament, then I would practice a little bit more. I approached it like a sport where, the more practice you put in, the better you get.
So you really kind of took the approach of doing, real world sports and sort of applied it to this online gaming environment. Now, you're 20 years old. What's the future hold for you? What are you doing now and where are you going to go?
Well, for right now, I have a company, Gamers Extreme, that I co-founded with three other guys. We're running the website and www.gamers.com.
Right.
We're also writing books and stuff, but as far as professional gaming goes, I'm just taking it one step at a time, going with the flow basically.
That sounds like a professional football player saying, oh yeah, I'm taking it one step at a time, I'm gonna see it. That's all for the team, that kind of thing. But now the other point is that you've written a book called, what is it, Quake 2? Strategy game?
The newest book that I've co-written, co-authored, is the official Quake 2 strategy guide.
Okay.
And, you know, I put down pretty much all my tips and secrets and stuff, and it's published by Cybex. And, you know, it just hit the stores. I think it's hitting the stores today.
Wow.
And so, you know, we're pretty excited.
So what's next? Who knows?
Yeah, well, right now I'm focused on the Professional Gaming League, the PGL. And, you know, after that's done, I'm basically just going to go with whatever comes up. I mean, professional gaming itself is growing so rapidly that, you know, you never really know what, you know.
The sky's the limit.
Well, one form of gaming online is real gaming, as in gambling with real money, as in your money. And some people think that's not a real good idea. Jon Swartz, you're one of them. How you doing?
Hi, nice to meet
you. So you cover technology for the San Francisco Chronicle.
Right.
And what's so bad about online gambling?
Well, it's very easy to sign up, and it's very easy to lose money.
Like gambling.
Like gambling, except there's no regulation for online gambling.
What do you mean by no regulation?
Well, casinos in Las Vegas are under certain rules that there is a certain percentage of people
so
who
So you're in a state somewhere, you got a terrestrial footing.
Right, right. I mean, there's some chance of you actually winning. With online gambling, there's no regulation. Therefore, you could be literally sending your money away to some place in Grenada, which you'll never get back or never see.
All right, let's talk about some of the sites out there first, and then we'll get back to the sort of the moral issue there. I know Virtual Vegas, for example, is one of them. Now, they claim they're a U.S.-based place, and you log on there. I mean, how do you actually go about gambling and spending money and so on?
Well, you go to a place like Virtual Vegas or Starlight Casino or Inter Casino.
Right.
Log on with your name, address, email address, and your credit card number, your all-important
credit card number.
Without that, you're all bets are off, so to speak.
All right.
But what you do is you fill that form out, and eventually you are able to gamble immediately. You set up an account with the company. They check your credit card to see you have enough money.
Right.
And you can spend as long as your credit card holds out.
All right, so that's some sort of Java-tized roulette wheel or blackjack table going on.
Blackjack, poker, slot machines, football, gambling, every conceivable type of gambling.
All right, it's easy to understand how I can spend money. How do I collect if I win?
That's a good question. That's a very good question, hence the unregulated aspect. I mean, the casinos that I talked to said that eventually if you do win, you will be credited in an account online, and that eventually they will pay you. But I think it's a very, very...
A little scary prospect,
very
isn't it?
Scary prospect.
Yes, I mean, the odds are, of course, they're counting on the fact that nobody ever wins, right? I'm playing on their money. You know?
You're playing on their money, and you're using your money. I mean, there are instances where you'll be sitting in the privacy of your own home. You don't have to go to Las Vegas or Atlantic City, and you can plunk down $500, and not knowing whether you'll ever get that money back.
Hey, is this any worse? I mean, isn't that inherent in the web? I mean, you know, kids can go to, or anybody can go to a, you know, pay-as-you-go porn site and be cranking away $5 a minute, you know, just to watch some sex show or something.
That's my greatest concern as a parent, and I am a parent.
Yeah.
What if little Johnny gets a credit card, says, hey, this might be fun to try the roulette, and decides to start gambling, and her parents come home and get a $1,000 bill. It's kind of tantamount to a kid getting onto a phone and making long-distance phone calls and getting the bill later.
So what's the future of this? I mean, I know there's some issue about legislation to prevent this.
Right. There's a lot of legislation. Actually, there's a very broad coalition against online gambling. There's a very conservative senator in Arizona who has a bill that would penalize people who were caught gambling online. Right now, there really is no law on the books. It's that would penalize the people who gamble. And because most of the companies are based overseas, it's hard to prosecute them. Although in one case, Missouri Attorney General is trying to extradite one of the executives of one of the gambling casinos.
But if you could regulate, I mean, theory, is there really anything wrong about a guy who likes to gamble being able to do it on a website?
No.
I mean, why have to drive to Nevada?
No, you don't. I mean, you can do it from the privacy of your home. I mean, you can do anything from the privacy of your home on the internet now. I mean, you can gawk through a pornographic magazine. You can squander as much money as you please. I mean, that's your right. It's just that there are a lot of people who are concerned that those people who are targeted as gambling customers tend to be from lower middle income families and tend to squander what money they do have.
So your advice right now, based on the way it's being run at the moment, is what?
Gamble on the non-cash sites. Virtual Vegas has a site where you can win T-shirts, different types of prizes.
Not real money.
Not real money.
Don't put real money on the web.
I think it's a sucker's bet.
All right, so we've taken a look at online gaming, seen some examples now, and I tend to agree with something you said at the beginning of the show about community building. Listen, Acrophobia, that was a great implementation of online gaming, using the bandwidth well. Lots of people getting together, they can play the game, they can talk, you meet people. I thought it was a great example of stuff you can do online you can't do in the real world.
But, Stewart, if you remember what I said is, I'm not sure whether this is good community building.
Okay, and do you want to be in a community that these other people
belong to? Exactly.
I
mean, NetStorm, you know, it's this strategy fantasy game, sacrificing priests. I mean, I don't know. Who are these guys?
You want friends like this.
That's the question, you know. So I'm not sure if this is the best use
of
the technology.
You think it's still sort of loner, get-a-life type people who are into this?
I think there might be a lot of sort of Star Trek convention type people that are playing these games right now.
But we like Star Trek.
You're right.
All right, what do you think?
Great.
What do you think?
I think that Quake is not my game.
Why?
Makes me nauseous.
Ten minutes physically
in.
Physically,
you get
moving around in 360.
Yeah, but I could play You Don't Know Jack all night long. I loved it.
That you think is cool?
Oh, it's totally fun. Yeah.
Well, that's another Berkeley Systems thing like Acrophobia.
But I'm not killing anybody or anything like that. I'm just, you know.
And you'd like your kids to do that?
I don't mind.
It's very funny,
I had them.
Too, the humor that's in that game.
So if you do it well, same old story, it's okay. Yes. All right, that's our look at online gaming. We'll be back here again next week at the Internet Cafe.
NetCafe is made possible by RonDiamond.com, the oldies site on the Internet. Music and memories from the 50s, 60s, and 70s, not just another jukebox. Additional support comes from the law offices of Ivan Hoffman, lawyering with integrity for internet law, copyright, trademark, and other intellectual property law. And by TechWeb for up-to-the-minute technology news. To purchase a videotape copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-310-7850. Please specify the show number and the topic.